This week on Vaticano, find out about the curial reforms taking place at the Vatican with the publication of the Apostolic Constitution, promulgated by Pope Francis, Predicate Evangelium, or Preach the Gospel. Sit down with Christian Alting van Geusau from the International Theological Institute on what it means to be a Catholic in politics and discover what the situation is like for Catholics in Kazakhstan. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. Pope Francis described himself as a pilgrim of peace when he landed in Nur-Sultan, the capital of Kazakhstan, on September the 13th. The papal trip to the Central Asian country, home to a small Catholic minority, was to last 3 days. The official motto of the papal visit was Messengers of Peace and Unity. Already at the first meeting with representatives of the Kazakh government, the pontiff emphasized that religious freedom is the best basis for a good social coexistence. A good policy, Francis said, can be recognized by the fact that it listens to people and responds to their legitimate needs. Accordingly, only a truly democratic style of politics is ultimately the most effective response to possible extremism, personality cult, and populism that threatens the stability and well-being of peoples. The Pope's participation in the 7th Congress of Leaders of World and Traditional Religions at the Palace of Peace and Reconciliation in Nur-Sultan was awaited with great excitement. The interfaith meeting took place on the second day of the trip, and in addition to the Holy Father and Vatican Secretary of State, Cardinal Pietro Parolin, representatives of Judaism, Islam, Orthodoxy, and Buddhism were also present. Fratelli e sorelle. In his address, Francis stressed that the various religions must work together to find an answer to the global challenges of today.
Religion is not a problem, but part of the solution for a more harmonious life in society. The pursuit of transcendence and the sacred value of fraternity can inspire and illuminate the decisions that need to be made amid the geopolitical, social, economic, ecological, but fundamentally spiritual crises that many modern institutions, including democracies, are presently experiencing, to the detriment of security and concord among peoples. We need religion in order to respond to the thirst for world peace and the thirst for the infinite that dwells in the heart of each human.
With regard to current conflicts, the Pope repeated his appeal that religions must never be instrumentalized by politics for armed conflicts. The sacred must not become the support of power, Francis admonished. It's not in armaments that one must invest, he said, but in education. In this context, the Holy Father also denounced the practice of abortion in the assembly.
Today we find it hard to accept the human being. Each day children, born and unborn, migrants and elderly persons, are cast aside. Many of our brothers and sisters die, sacrificed on the altar of profit, amid clouds of the sacrilegious incense of indifference. Yet every human being is sacred.
For the Catholic minority in Kazakhstan, the highlight of the Pope's trip followed in the afternoon at the expo site in Nur-Sultan. According to Kazakh news agencies, 7,000 faithful received the Holy Father to celebrate Holy Mass with him. On the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross, Pope Francis spoke about the importance of the cross, where Christ himself took the poison from the serpent of evil. Before returning to Rome on September the 15th, the Holy Father signed a joint declaration for peace with the other participants of the 7th Congress of Leaders of World and Traditional Religions. There's still too much hatred and division, too much lack of dialogue and understanding for the other, Francis lamented in his brief address. Politics and religion should therefore neither be mixed nor separated.
Hello and welcome to this week's Vaticano Updates, the most important news from the Holy Father and the Vatican. On September the 8th, Queen Elizabeth II, the longest reigning monarch in British history, died at the age of 96 at Balmoral Castle in Scotland after a brief illness. Pope Francis, in a telegram, offered his condolences and wrote, "I willingly join all who mourn her loss in praying for the late Queen's eternal rest and in paying tribute to her life of unstinting service to the good of the nation and the Commonwealth. Her example of devotion to duty, her steadfast witness of faith in Jesus Christ, and her firm hope in His promises." The role of the Church in a world shaken by war and other global issues was a subject Pope Francis raised with his diplomatic representatives around the globe during a meeting at the Vatican. The Holy Father warned against the risks of nuclear escalation and the grave economic and social consequences. In his official address, Pope Francis thanked the diplomats for bringing his closeness to the peoples and churches. Approximately 150 Catholic bishops attended the first week-long session of the formation course in Rome after a COVID-caused hiatus. The seminar for bishops, usually held annually, culminated in an audience with Pope Francis in the Vatican's Clementine Hall on September the 8th. The Vatican did not release any information about what was said during the meeting. After some German bishops blocked a vote demanding changes to the Church's teaching on sexuality during the German Synodal Way, organizers voiced their displeasure with the outcome and vowed to take it to Rome. Bishop Georg Betzing expressed personal disappointment that a blocking minority of bishops prevented the document pushing for changes to the Church's teaching on homosexuality and gender identity from being officially adopted. Pope Francis has exhorted Catholics in Germany in a 2019 letter to follow a path of synodality that seeks the new evangelization, but also warned of not wanting to have another what he called Protestant church in Germany. With the next Worldview Day less than a year away, Pope Francis has promised that a pope will be in attendance. In an interview with CNN Portugal, the Holy Father said that he plans to attend the 2023 Worldview Day. It is scheduled to take place in Lisbon next August. "I plan to go. The Pope is going to go," he said, "either Francis or John the 24th. But the Pope is going," he choked. Thank you for watching this week's Vaticano Updates. I'm Andreas Thonhauser for EWTN Vaticano.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. The Pope and his Curia. Many legends surround the Vicar of Christ on Earth and his staff of advisors. Many women and men from all over the world work in the Curia and support the Pope in steering the ship of Peter through the storms of time. The Pontiff and his team worked for many years on the Apostolic Constitution Predicate Evangelium, or Preach the Gospel. It was released in March of 2022 and underlined that any member of the faithful can lead one of the newly constituted Vatican dicasteries or other bodies, given their particular competence, power of governance, and function. Predicate Evangelium replaced Pastor Bonus, the apostolic constitution on the Roman Curia, promulgated by Pope John Paul II in 1988, and later modified by both Popes Benedict XVI and Pope Francis.
The most important innovations are the grouping of the dicasteries. That is, that different dicasteries or institutions of the Holy See are grouped together. So those are the most important decisions. Then also the expansion of the financial sector with the Secretariat of the Economy and various other institutions to facilitate transparency in the Holy See's asset management.
The Holy Father is not only concerned about the optics. Already in his Christmas address to the Curia staff in 2016, Pope Francis had emphasized,
"La riforma per questo non ha un fine estetico."
Consequently, the aim of reform is not aesthetic, an effort to improve the looks of the Curia, nor can it be understood as a sort of facelift, using makeup and cosmetics to embellish its aging body, nor even as an operation of plastic surgery to take away its wrinkles.
Per togliere le rughe.
Ja, das ist für ihn ja, hat ein
Evangelium. He wants that, first of all, everyone experiences this so-called missionary conversion for themselves. That faith is not seen as something that entails the preservation of vested interests, but that one goes to the margins and proclaims this faith and lives it out and tries to be missionary, both in the proclamation of faith and in catechetical and charitable work above all. This is how he envisions the church. That is why he has given this primacy to evangelization. Also, by placing the dicastery of evangelization first in the order of dicasteries. The whole reform of the Curia is based on principles that have basically remained the same since the Second Vatican Council. Already then, the bishops had called for decentralization, internationalization, and more involvement in the local churches.
Und mehr Einbezug der Ortskirche.
Decentralization and internationalization are reflected in the curial reforms. In many decisions that the Curia previously made only in consultation with the Pope, the local bishops' conferences are now more frequently involved.
Die Chance ist, dass es eine,
it's both bishops' conferences and bishops that's often mentioned. In consultations with bishops' conferences and the bishops, this and that should be decided. The change is that there will be a more decentralized decision-making, in which the universal church will be involved in many things, which has already been the case so far, without it being explicitly in there. The problem is, as we have experienced in various cases where we have questioned bishops' conferences, that opinions differ very widely. I would even say that the reform of the Curia has strengthened the papal primacy, because he himself says, all offices in the Curia are vicariate offices. So they have a share in his fullness of office, and that has actually been strengthened rather than diminished by it.
Especially in times in which the church, especially in Europe, is in serious crisis and the faith seems to be increasingly evaporating, Pope Francis elevates the proclamation of the good news, evangelization, to the highest priority. This is being reflected in the reform of the Curia that he has implemented. Monsignor Marcus Graulich sees a dynamic principle anchored in it.
Yeah.
Yes, if you always have to ask yourself, is this really serving evangelization? Then it is a constant questioning of one's own work. But if you only do an administration, that is, you get a question, you then answer it, this dynamic principle, on the other hand, is proactive. So, then the Curia would also say, now we have to place value on this particular thing. Now we have to respond to this challenge and not just always react to requests that are made.
We're here in the hillside outside of Rome, where Catholic legislators have been meeting for the last years, almost every year, to come together to share ideas, share experiences, pray together, but also learn a bit more about pressing issues of our time. With me here is the initiator of ICLN, that stands for the International Legislators Network, which is organizing this four-day retreat, Mr. Christian Alting von Geusau. Thank you for being here. And maybe, Christian, you can explain to us a little bit, what does it mean to be a Catholic legislator?
Well, first of all, in the name it already says it, International Catholic Legislators Network. What does it mean to be a Catholic legislator? One of the most important things there is that as a legislator, one understands that not the party, not the state, not the president, but Christ comes first. That's the most important for a Catholic legislator, and that's the biggest challenge for any Catholic legislator, because of course the secular world, in which also Catholic legislators actively participate and should participate, requires them often to choose allegiance. And choosing that Christ is my first priority and my faithfulness to Christ is a big challenge, and we want to help legislators with that.
And so this, you say this is a big challenge.
Yes.
Do you also encounter politicians, legislators who come here who have this topic, and how can they benefit from a meeting like this? What are they discussing here?
Well, first of all, the motto of our organization is Faith Formation Fellowship. And that's where we're really about. We are completely nonpartisan. We are not an activist organization. We don't do lobbying. What we want to do is we want to bring them here. We want to strengthen them in their faith. We want to give them good education in the topics that matter, good formation, good information. We really want to have them all round informed on the pressing issues. And then thirdly, the fellowship part is so essential because it shows them that they're not alone in their daily battle, their daily challenge to remain faithful Christians and at the same time serve in public office in the secular world. And we have already seen that that leads very often to very positive results.
Part of ICLN, part of the meeting here is usually always an encounter with the Holy Father. And I understand that also this year there will be an encounter of the legislators with Pope Francis. What has been his message to the legislators over the years?
The Holy Father really stresses that politics is a vocation to which also Christians are called and to which Christians are very much called. And he also always challenges us that we should not be afraid to get dirty hands, that he likes to say that. So he's been really encouraging Christians to go into the world of politics, to serve their societies, and also really not to be afraid to stand up for that which the church has always been, of course, the great defender of, especially human dignity, human rights, but also the family, children. All these themes have come up, and of course also the persecuted Christians.
Why do we need Catholics in politics?
What do Catholics bring into politics? They bring a much broader perspective into politics because Catholic social teaching and the whole Christian tradition brings in such a deep understanding of what it means to be human. The Church alone, with all its encyclicals, all its other documents that speak about issues that pertain to politics, to society, are so rich. And Catholics who are educated, of course, they have to be educated and well-formed, they bring this long tradition of wisdom of the Church about what it means to be human into politics. And that can only be good for politics. So it's a broadening of the horizon.
Christian, thank you very much for your time and for your thoughts and also all the experiences that you shared with us. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for the conversation.
We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. Kazakhstan is a country that experienced a lot of suffering. Different nationalities suffered here. After the October Revolution, half of the Kazakh people were exterminated. From 4 million Kazakhs, only 2 million remained in Kazakhstan at that time. The rest died of starvation, especially, or escaped somewhere abroad. If you go to the Spassk, near Karaganda, there are dozens of monuments of different nationalities, from Spain to Japan. The Karaganda camp is officially stated the territory of France, a land of suffering, an ocean of blood and tears.
But the totalitarian regime sank in this ocean of tears, and now a rock of faith triumphs in Karaganda. The Bishop of Karaganda, Adelio De Loro, witnessed the growth and development of the Catholic Church here.
In Kazakhstan, c'è una storia In Kazakhstan, there is a painful and beautiful history of the presence of Catholicism. With the Soviet deportations, Catholics finally returned after the years of Saint Francis of Assisi. Those deported were mainly Germans, Poles, Ukrainians, but also other nationalities. For 70 years, the faith was communicated mainly by grandmothers to their grandchildren, with almost no presence of priests and sacraments.
Bishop Evgeny Dzinkovsky, a descendant of deported families, says the faith is growing in Kazakhstan, despite the fact that many Catholics have left the country and gone on to live in Europe in search of a better life.
Until quite recently, the Catholics of Kazakhstan were the descendants of Catholics deported to Kazakhstan. But now we can notice with joy that the Catholic faith is spreading. That is why not only Germans, Poles, or Lithuanians come to our church now, but also people of different nationalities.
During these years, the church in Kazakhstan began to spread the faith to the local population. Sister Alma takes us to the lower church to introduce us to the statue of Our Lady of Karaganda.
We have a very interesting and important statue of the Virgin of Karaganda here at the Church of Our Lady of Fatima. Mary is dressed in the clothes of a Kazakh woman, clothes that only a woman who gave birth to her firstborn child would wear. And all the jewelry she wears on her head and hands is exactly like that worn by a Kazakh woman. The Virgin Mary is not someone who would stand still and expect us to come to her. She is the one who comes. She came to the Kazakh people. She came to all the people here. With one foot in front of the other, she brings Jesus to us.
Another important milestone in the development of the Catholic Church in Kazakhstan was the creation in 1994 of a Catholic seminary in Karaganda for the formation of local clergy. The new rector, Father Ruslan Rakimberlinov, is an alumnus of the seminary and the first priest of Kazakh nationality.
It is an interdiocesan seminary, so we have here students that are trained not only for Kazakhstan, but also we have representatives from other countries, from other dioceses, such as Russia and Georgia. We had also Armenian students, and this year we expect students from the Belarus Greek Catholic Church. More than 20 priests have graduated from this seminary, including myself. I graduated in 2008. This is our chapel, where we meet with educators and students. Every day, we have an early morning Holy Mass and Rosary prayer, and Liturgy of the Hours. This is the heart of the seminary. This is where seminarians are formed and educated to be priests, servants of the church, and God. The presence of the seminary itself here on our land is a great hope for us, because it is no secret that the seminary is the heart not only of the diocese, but it is the hope for the development of the whole church in Kazakhstan.
Another significant development for the church in Kazakhstan happened this year. The Holy See decided to merge the national bishops' conferences of several Central Asian countries into one single bishops' conference, headquartered in Kazakhstan.
In April of this year, the first meeting of the new bishops' conference took place, and it is called the Central Asian Catholic Bishops' Conference. In addition to Kazakhstan, there are four former Soviet republics: Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Turkmenistan, and Mongolia and Afghanistan. Seven countries altogether. And we all went to the lake sanctuary of the Queen of Peace. And there, this new reality of the new conference was entrusted to the Mother of God, the Queen of Peace, by the mouth of the conference chairman, Bishop Jose Luis, taking into account the situation that is happening now around the world, especially keeping in mind the war in Ukraine. We see that we have a special obligation to pray for peace in Ukraine and around the world.